everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. If you do not know me yet, my name is Ashley Hall. I'm the 4-H assistant professor working with WSU 4-H in Snohomish County. I want to thank Modest Family Solutions in conjunction with Facts Over Fear for providing this fantastic opportunity for our WSU 4-H and community members. I hope this series is going to open up a line of communication for myself and for each of you that will enable us to learn and grow and become allies to our Muslim neighbors and really all of our neighbors that face fear and discrimination in our community. So I'm going to turn it over to Adasha Turner, founder of Modest Family Solutions.
Hi, thank you, Ashley. Yes, a little bit of background about me. My name is Adasha Turner. I am a retired clinical neurophysiologist. I used to do work at Stanford in the Traumatic Brain Injury Institute that took care of our soldiers coming back from the first Iraqi war that were directly impacted by shell shock, which was really traumatic to me to be on both ends of giving care and then being that kind of reciprocal of misinformation for the soldiers coming back. And so I've spent my career traveling for 15 years and found myself in a lot of the same predicaments to where, you know, putting our intersectionalities aside and really addressing the humanity that the Quran calls for. I have been blessed to run into Anila and Pastor Terry with the Facts Over Fear program because they speak to this in depth. And I just think that it's an awesome platform for us all to come together to have these difficult conversations that's guided through research and facts, you know, to get over these fears that we have within our communities to where we're able to welcome each other and kind of stand as, you know, true brothers and sisters, you know, on this planet, you know, and in this country.
Hello, everyone. My name is Terry Kylo. I'm a Lutheran pastor. Anila and I will both share some more information about ourselves here in just a few minutes. But first, we just want to say thank you to WSU, to the Extension, to the 4-H organization and Modest Family Solutions for having us today. This webinar will be about an hour in length. We invite you to ask questions and to do so using the Q&A feature, and we'll be monitoring that, and we'll have an extended time of Q&A toward the end of the session today. This will also be videotaped, and so we'll be sending out a link to this. It's also on Facebook Live right now, and so you'll be able to watch it on Facebook as well at the Paths to Understanding Facebook page. So again, thank you for joining us. So we just want to be really clear with you that we have a really different like way of approaching this than a lot of folk. Like, we just don't believe in naming and shaming people is really very helpful. So our whole approach is really based on helping to share common values, to share positive stories, and to help people get to know each other really well, and then eventually to work together for the common good. So you're not going to be shamed in the midst of this process. In fact, we want to teach you a way to encounter other people who may be fearful of their Muslim neighbors or Jewish neighbors or just anyone else who's different, with a way for you to have conversation with them that's deeply respectful of them, that meets their fears, meets them where they are, but also helps them to calm themselves from their fears, because being fearful is no fun for any of us. I have been a Lutheran pastor for about 30 years now. This is my mom and dad and family and my sister and brother in the town of La Crosse, Washington, a town of 300 people, about 50 miles to the west of Pullman. Pullman was the place I went to on my first date, because there's no restaurants in La Crosse, really, no movies or anything. This is a picture of me at Friel Court playing at the B-Boys district basketball as a senior. And so that's me making that move there. And you can see me as a pastor serving in this point in an Episcopal church. I've served in both Lutheran and Episcopal churches. And these photos here are of my dad, harvesting wheat just south of Pampa, just south of La Crosse, really. And of course, my dad ended up losing the farm because mechanization was just making it, you know, ever more difficult to do wheat farming without a lot of land. And so this is my dad, who planted 5,000 trees near Sabu Lutheran Church, south of La Crosse, and managed to keep the trees alive. And then the last picture there up on the left is from Kemi Ibute, where I invited my wife to consider marrying me. So that's just a little bit about me. I've been a Lutheran pastor, like I said, for 30 years and have been doing the work of countering anti-Muslim bigotry for about the last 4 years. And there's a couple reasons why. First is that I'm a Lutheran pastor. And as a Lutheran, I realized I needed to learn from the mistakes of my Lutheran ancestors in Germany in the 1930s, who failed all too often to stand up for their Jewish sisters and brothers. And we all know what happened because of that. Second is because I'm an American and I'm a proud American and I believe in our aspirational constitutional values. And I know that we have sometimes fallen short of those values and all too often done that. But the reason that I've stayed in it, even though those were the reasons I began, is because I've gotten to know so many American Muslims and I've recognized my own humanity in them and that I can't really be human or American without a relationship with them. And so I'm happy to join with you today. And now I'll turn it over to Anila to introduce herself.
Thank you so very much, dear brother, Reverend Terry, and hello, everybody. It is such an honor to be here with you. We're excited to be able to launch this webinar series, and we really hope that you will stay with us as part of the journey, this webinar series that we're going to have for 5 weeks. My name is Anila Afzali, and I am a proud American Muslim woman. I'm a U.S. citizen, a registered voter, and I firmly believe in God, family, and country. I grew up in the Bay Area, and my family moved to Portland when I was in middle school. And this is my family, you can see that. I've always had a strong sense of respect, dignity, fairness, and justice. It's part of the Islamic values that my parents taught me and my siblings growing up. My parents also worked really hard to survive and succeed, opening up 4 different mom and pop shops where my whole family worked because they wanted to build a better future for their children. Just like countless American Muslims across our nation, and just like all Americans and all of you, like other American Muslims, my parents also wanted us to grow up to be productive citizens and proud Americans, which I am, even if, as Reverend Terry mentioned, our country hasn't and doesn't always meet the aspirational ideals and values that I love about our country. I understand that we are all Americans and we are all in this together. Hopefully, like many of you, I'm a proud number 12, a Seahawks fan, go Hawks. And perhaps not like many of you, I'm also a proud University of Oregon Duck. And I say that despite living in a state full of Huskies and Cougs. I was in fact the first in my family to get to graduate from college, but fortunately not the last. And then I continued on, I was very blessed to continue on to Harvard Law School, fulfilling one of the teachings of Prophet Muhammad that men and women should pursue high levels of education. I worked at 2 different law firms after law school, became partner at one, and then continued on to become general counsel of a healthcare IT company. But now, as I tell people, I'm a recovering attorney. I actually left my legal career in 2013 after a spiritual transformation I had that made me question my life focus and priorities. I was also seeing so much misinformation and false witness being promoted about Islam and Muslims in our country. Since leaving my legal career, I've been working to address the growing divide that I see in our country, as this is really tearing our country apart from within. And this has only gotten worse, it seems, in the last few years. It has jeopardized the aspirational values about our country that I so love and that make me proud to be an American. That's why I do the work that I do. And for the past 7 years, I've been putting my faith values into action by working to build bridges of understanding and unity and following the teachings of Jesus and Muhammad, peace be upon them, and so many other wisdom leaders about loving God and loving our neighbors as ourselves, or the teachings of the golden rule that we cherish. And I feel honored to be on the front lines of this kind of work. I have personally had the enormous blessing to get to witness the kind of transformation that people have when they actually build relationships, when they actually get to meet a Muslim, rather than just seeing or believing or hearing the lies and the stereotypes and misinformation in media, in entertainment, and that's so prevalent around us. There are so many powerful stories of love, redemption, and transformation, and so many acts of kindness in response to the hate that we sometimes get overwhelmed with. And it's been so inspiring and uplifting to be part of this kind of work and to see and experience these kinds of transformations. And I'm fortunate to get to work with my dear brother, Reverend Terry Kylo, in our Facts Over Fear program, which really uses a research-based, unique messaging approach. And the content that you'll learn from the full webinar series will be useful to address other forms of hate and bigotry as well, not just the anti-Muslim variety. And this kind of training can also be especially useful for educators and those who are working with Muslim youth or students or others, like through the WAZU or 4-H organization. So thank you everybody for joining us today. And we look forward to this journey together.
So thank you, Anila. And now I'm gonna take you through a few slides here for a few minutes and share my screen and talk about what's happening for our Muslim neighbors across the country, and kind of some of the forces that are arrayed against them. And I just want to start off by saying that, you know, about maybe even 6 years ago, I was just as impacted by the hate messages toward our American Muslim neighbors as anybody. I grew up, like I said, in La Crosse. I didn't know anything about Islam. I didn't know anything about Muslims. I didn't really know hardly any Muslims at all until maybe 2014. And so I had heard all kinds of messages about our American Muslim neighbors, and I found myself captivated by them. And even after 6 years of hard work, I found myself that still having to do work to kind of counteract the bias and bigotry within myself. And so I just want to help you understand that, like, nobody is going to be pointing a finger at anybody today for having some biases. Like, we all have biases, and I still have mine. But we do want to invite you to work on them so that we can learn to live with each other the way I think our founders intended in this country, and the way I believe that we can as human beings. So in 2015, a poll was made by PPP Polling. Should the US bomb Agrabah? 25% were in favor and 51% were not sure. That means that roughly 75% were in favor or not sure about bombing a city. And think about what's in a city. You have water lines, you have power lines, you have nursing homes and hospitals and daycares and schools. The fact that 75% of us were kind of willing to entertain bombing a vaguely Arabic sounding name, well, that tells us something about the bigotry and the bias toward our American Muslim neighbors. But of course, the problem is that Agrabah doesn't exist except in the Disney digital vault in the movie Aladdin. And now, of course, it's on Disney Plus, right?
So, Reverend Terry, I'm sorry to interrupt. Can you make your slides larger for folks? We can see the other.
I don't know that I can. I think it's the way it is. I'm very sorry about that. I don't know why that's happening.
Okay. We can see the next slide too.
Oh, you can. Okay, hold on, folks. Let me try to do this one more time.
I know we're all challenged with technology at times. It's okay. You were able to get it before when we did the check.
Yeah, so. I know. I think I understand what happened. Okay, here we go. Thank you, Anila. Okay, so there's a lot of fear happening, and we know what happens with fear. Once fear is in us, even if the fear is not real, about something real, the fear becomes real itself. And so there's this gentleman named Irvin Staub who's done a lot of work on why societies and countries sort of get captivated by fear to the point of doing mass violence. And he says that there's a couple of pieces to this. First is that there's a cultural self-concept of superiority, and at the same time, a sense of persecution. And it usually gets sort of woven around a story like this, that if we just get rid of these people, those people, everything would be fine. There's also some difficult life conditions in societies that tend toward mass violence, with some long-standing racism underneath that. But he also says that something can happen that can interrupt that process of mass violence. And that's called people moving from being passive bystanders to being active ones. He said that in societies where people stood up with each other and were able to say, hey, wait a minute, these folk are human, they're our sisters and brothers, they're a part of us, that they were able to interrupt that kind of difficult dynamic of demonization and dehumanization. And that's a lot of what I'm trying to do, just so you know. So we know that racism begins, as Ibram X. Kendi teaches, with economic, political, and cultural self-interests. Then what happens is that it becomes expressed in racially discriminatory policies. It then gets justified by racist ideas that then create ignorance and hate in people, and all of which become kind of a mutually, you know, a cycle that just keeps perpetuating itself. And this has certainly happened not only toward our American Muslim neighbors, but our Jewish neighbors, our African-American neighbors, our indigenous neighbors, and so many more. But we have to understand that there are some economic and political and cultural self-interest that sort of begin the whole thing. Unfortunately, it impacts everybody. We also know that racism is expressed intrapersonally. That is, it's within myself, either toward myself or toward others. It's interpersonal. It's between the way we communicate to each other, the way we relate to each other. But it also gets expressed institutionally, and it gets expressed structurally. And I'll explain some of those in a few minutes. So there's not a Muslim I know that hasn't had to work some with themselves on their on the way the larger racism toward Muslims has impacted them, their own self-concept and the way that they experience life. But when they go to a mosque, what Muslims are taught is, oh humankind, we've created you from a male and a female and have made you into nations and tribes for you to know one another. In other words, Muslims are taught that diversity of culture and religion is a good part of the creation. And that means that our own distinctiveness is also good. And so when you go to a mosque, what you're going to see is people wishing peace upon people who are part of them and who come and join them, and people in their community as they work to help serve the community, meet basic needs, provide food and other kinds of support for their larger community. We also know that our Muslim neighbors experience interpersonal racism. We have seen a 17% increase between 2015 and 2017 in anti-Muslim bias incidents and a 15% increase in hate crimes. We have seen the same sort of thing happen in the last few years where we're getting to kind of a plateau where both our Jewish neighbors and our Muslim neighbors are receiving pretty high levels of hate crimes across the country. And these numbers, of course, represent only 14% of jurisdictions reporting to the FBI. We know as well that Muslims experience religious discrimination a fair bit, with 62% of Muslims reporting some kind of religious discrimination. Jews experience that about 43% of the time, and white evangelicals about 36% of the time. And what Muslims are taught about this is that the good deed and the evil deed are not equal. Repel by that which is better, then behold, the one between whom and thee there is enmity shall be as if he were a loyal protecting friend. In other words, this is love your enemy and pray for those that persecute you. It's the same sort of idea. Muslims also experience institutional racism. So for instance, Cargill was down in Colorado was willing to close down their break room because some Muslims were using one little corner of it to pray during the day. And the Teamsters Union was unwilling to support them. And so there was a lawsuit about that. because of course they should be allowing folk to go use a corner of the break room to pray. It's like not that big a deal. We also find that in schools, roughly 42% of all Muslim households or families report some kind of bullying per year. And that 25% of the time that bullying takes place by teachers or administrators. So that's an example of institutional racism. We also see it from the media, where people that are perceived to be Muslims who perpetrate certain crimes receive more than twice the amount of news coverage than those that are not perceived to be Muslim. So for instance, one of the questions we like to ask is this: who is this guy? And this guy's name is Dylan Roof, and he killed 9 people at Mother Emanuel Church a number of years ago in a very sad incident. How many of us know the religion of Dylan Roof? Well, actually, Dylan Roof was Lutheran. He grew up in the same kind of church that I have worked in for 30 years. But because he was Christian, it just kind of wasn't news what his faith tradition was. We have a lot of churches and a lot of faith leaders across the country who talk very, very badly about Islam and who bear, frankly, a lot of false witness about it because they really don't know much about it at all. Franklin Graham is one of those. But we also not only have conservative sort of, anti-Muslim bigotry, we also have liberal anti-Muslim bigotry. So this is a Bill Maher who brought on a white nationalist. Bill Maher speaks terribly about Muslims and many other faith communities on his show, but especially has it out for Muslims. And so there's liberal Islamophobia too. It kind of goes across the board. But the thing that really shocked me about 5 or 6 years ago was when I'd go out and do a little presentation with another Muslim friend of mine, we would see the same questions in almost the same order and the same phraseology everywhere we went. And like, I had to ask myself, like, why is that there? Like, is it the same crowd following us around? And it wasn't. What it was that there are anti-Muslim hate groups that spend over $30 million a year. And we know it's more than that, but this is what we can verify. They spend $30 million a year to do white papers for government folks. They write books for everybody. They do tons of YouTube videos. They build networks. They do social media. They write blogs. They do media appearances. They do lobbying. And they do messaging studies. So they work very, very hard to try to figure out in the shortest possible way how to make other folk afraid of Muslims. So if you've ever heard of the term Sharia law, well, that's a term that they came up with. The anti-Muslim hate industry came up with this. And again, these aren't like folk running around in white robes. These are folk with fancy ties and with lots of like video capability. These are people with connections. And they spend this much money in an active dehumanization campaign against our American Muslim neighbors. This is also institutional racism. So they go by lots of names. The Act for America is one of them. The Center for Security Policy is another one, but there's over 30 other ones that are really powerful. And they work to generate fear. And here's the problem, is it's easier to create fear of a group on YouTube or social media than it is to create connection or respect or love or understanding. And so their $30 million is very, very powerful. But there's also structural racism against our American Muslim neighbors. So for instance, in the movies in the last century, Professor Jack Shaheen found that of the 1,000 depictions of American Muslims or Arabs in the movie industry, only 12 of those depictions were positive, 52 were neutral, and 936 were negative. So if you're just watching a movie like I did in La Crosse, Washington, watching the Saturday afternoon movies, you got a negative depiction of Muslims. In a study done in 2013 of major TV news sources, they found that Islam received 50% of the coverage about religious folk, even though they make up about 2% of the population. And of that coverage, only about 5% of it was positive. The rest was neutral or mostly negative. So if you just turn on the news at night, you're mostly going to hear negative news. I once met with a bunch of Muslims for a peace conference, and the B-roll video behind our conversation was all of violence happening. And that's the kind of thing we always see in the news. We see headlines like this from the Washington Times that was quoting a UNC and Duke study saying that the majority of fatal attacks in the US are carried out by white supremacists. But you can see the way they framed the headline so as to identify terrorists, the T word, with almost solely with Muslims. But just to be clear, the New York Times, according to 416 Labs, referred to Muslims and Islam more negatively than they did cancer or cocaine. So there's Islamophobia across the ideological spectrum. And in sentencing, people experience a great deal of its structural Islamophobia and anti-Muslim bigotry by getting three times the sentence if you appear to be a Muslim than if you appear not to be. And of course, that goes against our 14th Amendment rights to equal protection under the law. We also see across the state, across the country, actually, a lot of anti-Sharia legislation. And the intent of the legislation isn't to really change anything, because the US Constitution already says there can't be any religion imposed on anybody in this country, that we have freedom of religion. But their intent was to use that legislation once it's passed to sort of scare people more and again, create one of those terrible cycles. We also see a lot of governmental Islamophobia. And recently we just had the Muslim ban set aside, but its impact is really powerful, not only in the everyday lives of American Muslims, but on the imagination of other Americans who think something needs to be done. What are Muslims taught about this? Oh, you who have believed, be persistently standing firm in justice, witnesses for God, even if it be against yourselves or your parents or your relatives. So we're seeing a terrible cycle of intrapersonal, interpersonal, institutional, and structural racism, kind of creating a self-generating cycle. And here's why it matters. In the last century, 262 million people were killed in genocides around the world. That's almost like 3/4 of the US population right now. And how did people get persuaded to do that? It's a process that is now called dangerous speech leading to mass violence. Someone proposes an us and a them. They begin to dehumanize the them in lots of different ways by saying that they're not really human, their ideology makes them inhuman, they're like bugs or animals or whatever, describing them in all kinds of terrible ways. And then we apply collective blame so that when any one person in the group does something wrong, that's about all of them. And it begins to develop a sense of threat and fear, and the fear becomes real even when it's really overblown or not real. And then the next part of the process is to say that there is no alternative, that violence is necessary and good against that group, and a peaceful future awaits if we act now, because if we don't do it to them, they're going to do it to us. And that's how the terrible thing happens. And so here's the big deal, is that it's not that the people who killed the 262 million people were convinced to do evil. They were convinced to do something wrong that they thought was right. And that's what that kind of negative speech does. That's how it functions to turn good people to do evil things. It works on us to build fear around that which we love to become that which later on we would regret. See, assuming the worst about another group evokes the worst in us. Fear is infectious, however, but we believe love can wash it away. Love and relationship and commitment to our foundational constitutional values. So it is the patriotic civic duty of every American to protect the civil rights of all, knowing the best way to protect our own rights is to uphold everyone's rights. Rights are not a limited good. There's not just a couple of them around. And if we don't stand up for the rights of our American Muslim neighbors, for our Jewish neighbors, for our Buddhist neighbors, well, then what's that going to say about our rights later on, no matter what tradition we're part of or whether we're part of a tradition or not? You know, we're not here to try to encourage you to become Muslim or Christian or religious in any way. But we do recognize that that we have right now a situation where some of our U.S. citizens, some of our American neighbors are being dehumanized on the basis of religion. And we really shouldn't stand up for that any more than we stand up for any other kind of dehumanization. Anila, I want to hand it over to you.
Thank you so very much, dear brother Terry. And thank you everybody for listening to that. Reverend Terry provided a great overview of the problem of anti-Muslim bigotry. And the remainder of our webinar series, starting next week and continuing for 4 weeks, we're going to be focusing on some of the specific myths and misconceptions that are promoted in our country about Islam and Muslims. And these are sort of around the four areas that also were mentioned in the audience poll that many of you took in the beginning. They have to do with women's rights. They have to do with peace or violence, folks would say. They have to do with loyalty or Sharia. And they have to do with Islam and other religions. And what we're going to be doing in the other webinar sessions is specifically talking to all of you and working together collectively to address how we respond to these kinds of misconceptions. Because if we can't stop these kinds of misconceptions and the misinformation and the disinformation out there, we will further go down into the sort of kind of division in our country that really hurts us all as Americans and really promotes, you know, more bizarre and more extreme conspiracy theories. And we're seeing some of that right now in our country already. So part of this Facts Over Fear program is that we actually created these 5 animated videos to address these myths and misconceptions. Those are all available on our Facts Over Fear website, and we actually will be playing those in our future webinars. And I also want to emphasize something, that what we teach and what we talk about through this program, it's really, as Reverend Terry said, it's about being patriotic. It's about being an American. It's about fulfilling our civic duties. It's about implementing our shared American values. And we really seek to uplift all of us collectively as a country and as individuals to ensure respect, dignity, and fairness. That's the point of this program. And the reason that we need to hold these kinds of trainings is because the majority of our fellow Americans, unfortunately, are being politically manipulated with the fiction and the fear-mongering when it comes to Muslims and Islam. And the consequences of the sort of anti-Muslim misinformation campaigns, it's really dangerous, certainly for Muslims, and it's even deadly, I would say, at times. This includes, you know, attacks on mosques, like this mosque that I'm with, the Muslim Association of Puget Sound. It includes hate crimes and threats to individual Muslim women, children, and families. I personally know folks who have been directly threatened, who have faced attacks, and sadly, even have had family members killed. And I myself, I've had people drive by, roll down their windows, and yell obscenities at me, tell me to go home, even if I'm a mile away from my home. You know, this is very real, and the impact of this kind of bigotry, it includes, as Reverend Terry mentioned, the impact on precious Muslim youth and students facing bullying in schools, even at the hands of their teachers and school administrators at times. It includes the discrimination at the work and in the public places. It includes family separation, surveillance of mosques, and so much more. But this kind of anti-Muslim bigotry, it doesn't just have an impact on Muslims. It actually impacts all of us as Americans. It affects every single American who cares about freedom and democracy, civility and decency. Because again, that misinformation campaign that's been promoted in our country attacks our shared American values like religious freedom. And it threatens all of our civil rights because it's driven by fear. And research shows us that fear makes us more willing to give up our liberties and our freedoms in the name of, quote, national security, end quote. In fact, that very same argument about national security was used against our Japanese American sisters and brothers as we put them in concentration camps during World War II and later regretted that horrible action as a nation. And beyond that, Islamophobia makes us all less safe in at least 2 ways. First, it provides recruiting material for violent criminals and cults out there. And second, it takes resources away from the actual criminals, the actual sources of threat in our country. We saw the deadly consequences of that with the Parkland, Florida mass attack on Valentine's Day, where law enforcement had received multiple reports about the suspect in the school shooting, but did not act. We see it in the almost exclusive focus on Muslims or people of color, which allowed for the attempted insurgency on January 6th and the threat of white nationalist groups to grow in our country and actually pose a risk to all of us as Americans. Bottom line, we need to have evidence-based investigations, which are more effective at keeping us all safe, not generalized prejudice based on faith or race, which is what Islamophobia is. And Islamophobia also opens the door to other forms of bigotry, because bigotry and discrimination, they're like a fire in a house. They can destroy and bring down the entire house. So it's not surprising that this misinformation propaganda campaign against Muslims has also led to non-Muslims facing attacks, like our Sikh American siblings or Indian Americans, or even a Catholic American Black man who was shot in the face next to a Walmart in Florida. And the person who shot him asked, "Are you Middle Eastern and are you Muslim?" before firing a gas-powered pellet gun at point-blank range. That criminal, he later told police that he didn't care that his victim wasn't Muslim, saying, "They're all the same." And we've also seen white Christian men who are also direct victims of anti-Muslim bigotry, with our Portland heroes who were attacked on the MAX train. The survivor, Micah, he's now a friend of mine. I've actually met with him and his family, along with the family of Talishan, one of the victims who was actually killed in that horrible MAX train attack in Portland. I've shared in their grief and witness that pain directly. And it breaks my heart to see and experience these kinds of unnecessary losses of life. So Islamophobia, this sort of anti-Muslim bigotry, it's an issue that affects all of us as Americans, as human beings, something we should all care about. And the impact on people themselves when they are filled with the kind of hate and fear that's promoted by the anti-Muslim industry is something else, something profound in and of itself. This is actually me at Act for America, the largest anti-Muslim hate group in our country, held a series of rallies, anti-Muslim rallies across our country. And this one was one at Seattle. And I remember going to this rally and actually putting up an Ask a Muslim sign and having people come to me and ask questions. And this couple showed up, the woman in the wheelchair, she actually had a sign on her lap that was an anti-Muslim sign. And she was, she and her husband were saying all kinds of, you know, some of the, again, the myths and misconceptions about Islam and Muslims. And I remember talking to her, and there was a point at which I ended up holding her hand and just speaking with her with care and compassion, because my faith gives me the strength to be able to do that. And we're having this moment, and a Reuters photographer happened to be there, and they captured this moment. I didn't know they were doing that. But it was, well, what really hit me is how much that hate and fear hurts individuals who have that in them. And I've seen this also in the roadshow. We did a series of roadshow events, Reverend Terry and I. We went to cities across the state of Washington, smaller rural towns, where we talked to people and talked about sort of what's happening with this industry and this misinformation campaign. And I remember our first one that we went to, and we didn't know what to expect. And we showed up in a small town, not knowing who's gonna be there. And we actually had far more people than we expected showing up, which was a great sign. And afterwards, I had two separate people come up to me, admit that they had been sort of holding anti-Muslim hate and fear, and that that was really affecting them themselves. And just that 2-hour session that we had together, that really uplifted them and that transformed them. And that they even were shedding some tears because they couldn't believe how much they had bought in to the lies and the misinformation. And we hugged, and it was just beautiful. And again, redemptive even in having those kinds of moments and seeing that kind of transformative impact that relationships and actual real knowledge and information about communities that are disparaged or marginalized, the kind of impact that that can have. And finally, I want to say that it's important to recognize that Islamophobia is really a continuation of the same narrative of fear, scapegoating, and otherization that is used against other minority communities here at home and abroad. The narrative and the script, they're very similar. All you got to do is change some of the characters and the labels. This is how the T word, terrorist, gets used the same way that another T word, thug, has been used in a different script, for instance, to demonize, criminalize, and terrorize entire communities. And really, ultimately, it's a tool to divide we the people, because we in fact have a lot in common as Americans, even if it doesn't always seem that way in a very divided country. And I will close by saying that as bad as things may seem at times, it is still an amazing time to be alive. And we cannot and will not let the haters or the hate prevail. I am so proud to be an American Muslim woman at this point in time, because never in my lifetime have I felt that we collectively have more power than we do today to make a real difference. Never in my lifetime have our collective words and actions been more critical in determining the future of our country. We, all of us, you and I, here on this call and out in the world, we are writing history right now with our words and our actions or inactions. We each have the incredible opportunity and the potential to make a real difference in the future soul and direction of our country. And we have a choice. We have a choice to make, to either remove the hate and fear and pursue a narrative of facts over, to remove that hate and fear and be able to actually pursue a narrative of facts over fiction, love over hate, and faith over fear, in order to create a more perfect union and a country and a community where we are all better off as one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anila. And I just want to let everybody know that you know, when Anila is talking about, you know, working for human rights, civil rights, she stands with many other communities, as do I. So she's out there working with all kinds of communities to make sure that we're remembering who we are as a nation, what our aspirational constitutional values are. And so she's just been so busy these last years, standing with all kinds of communities to help us recognize that we share so much together and we can stand with each other. So we're really happy to get some questions in the Q&A, and we encourage all of you to write other ones in. Beth has asked a question about the Islamophobia industry, about that term, and wants to understand more about that. And so what we have to understand is that anti-Muslim bigotry didn't get started at any particular historical event, including September 11th, 2001. Like it peaked a little bit there, and then it came right back down because we had national leadership at that point, President Bush, who went and went to a mosque and spoke well of Muslims, American Muslims. Where anti-Muslim bigotry began to rise was somewhere around 2008. And it is 2007, 2008, a number of groups began to form. And then they all kind of formed almost at the same time. They began to kind of catch a wave, and they began to get a lot of money. And so all these groups, these hate groups, came together and began to network with each other. And not only were they networking with each other, they began to do those messaging studies I talked about. They began to research how they could generate fear. They began to get more contributions. They began to write books. If Anila wanted to get rich and retire, all she'd have to do is write some false book about how terrible Islam is, and she would have enough money to retire on for the rest of her life. She could be in Cancun. I mean, from here on out.
Terry, I would just have to give up my integrity. Unfortunately, I'm not willing to do that.
Yeah, so part of what was difficult was trying to figure out what to name this thing, because it wasn't just one hate group. And the other piece is that a lot of the funding that comes to these groups is by people who want to sell weapons, because they want to have some enemy out there that they can gin up fear about. And of course, the problem with that is that then other vital needs of our country don't get spent money on. And bigger than that, our young women and men then get sent places where they don't really need to go, and they come back harmed and wounded. And so this anti-Muslim industry was a term that was like considered best to kind of describe the money making that's happening really off of fear, directed at our American Muslim neighbors. And that kind of fear is no good for any of us. And Anila, do you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I do. Thank you, Brother Terry. And also thank you, Beth, for that question. I think it's a great question. The piece that I would add is the reason we describe it as an industry is because there is a core, sort of an inner core of certain well-established groups that are promoting a certain anti-Muslim messaging that we were referencing before. And this sort of spreads out and it gets shared with a wider sort of echo chamber that really reinforces the messaging. And there's a significant amount of funding, just a matter of, I think it was like 5 years, there was over $205 million. And what I'm actually going to do is share just this screen. We usually, when we go and speak places, we actually have these flyers, these big posters for folks to go and examine. But this gives you a sense of some of the individuals and the organizations that are part of this machinery that seeks to peddle fear and profit off of it. Terry mentioned defense companies, absolutely, sort of the military industrial complex benefits from having this kind of fear promoted in our country. There are many other industries as well, the surveillance industry, for instance, or sort of the prison industrial complex, for instance. There are also foreign policy implications or reasons that there is anti-Muslim sentiment promoted by these groups successfully in our country, is because we need that kind of rationale to justify going and bombing certain places, for instance, at times, whether it's justified or not. So those are some. And there's actually a couple websites that we do share. Sort of Islamophobia.org is one place to go. And Islamophobianetwork.com is another place to go, where you can look at specifically which groups are part of this. And there's a book called The Islamophobia Industry by Nathan Lean, where he goes into, you know, full detail of sort of the rationale and the motivations for a lot of these organizations that are part of this network or this industry, however you want to describe it. But there's actual profit reasons and political reasons for these groups and individuals to be promoting what they do.
Well, and again, back to the point of my presentation, is that human beings are vulnerable, you know, to negative speech, to dehumanizing language about others. I mean, that's just the way we are. We are vulnerable to that. And that's why, for instance, in the Jewish tradition and the Christian tradition as well, it says, thou shalt not bear false witness against your neighbor. It's not just about lying to your mom about whether you ate a cookie. It's about how our attitudes about other groups can be shaped in such a way that we become more prone to violence against them. And because we are a nation of many peoples and many traditions, it's easy for us to become divided against each other. And that's what these groups are doing. These Islamophobia industry groups wrap themselves in the American flag, but they actually use that flag in a way that bears no resemblance to our aspirational constitutional values. And they're actually trying to pit us against each other as a country. And that doesn't mean we don't have differences, right? But we have processes in this country for how we handle those differences. And so it's really important for us to stand against this. So Amanda has just asked a question, Anila. What sort of legal routes can we go through to undermine the anti-Muslim industry? What can individuals do to denounce the anti-Muslim sentiment? How do we further uncover and expose the undercurrents of racism in social media? Anila, why don't you pick that up in about 2 minutes?
I will try. Amanda. Amanda, wonderful questions. Thank you for asking them. I'll actually start with the second half first, because I think that's very relevant to individuals who hear this presentation, who hear other information like this and want to do something. And I commend you for wanting to take action, because I'm always a big advocate of that. Some of the specific things we say is attend sessions like this. So you're already taking a great step in addressing some of this bigotry. Show up to these kinds of sessions and let's help educate ourselves and our family and our friends and our colleagues and more. Because as I tell people, you know, I can talk to people, but there are certain people who will never come and talk to somebody who looks like me. But they might listen to you, Amanda, or to Beth, or to, you know, Mike or John or anybody else. You have access to certain people. And now that you're getting this information, we really hope you will use the training, not just today, but the whole 5 weeks webinar series, to then go as ambassadors and help have conversations with sort of your own networks. In addition to that, there's also sort of on social media in particular, there's some specific advice that I give. And one of the things we say is we don't want folks arguing and debating, because people just further dig in their heels in their positions when we have these kinds of attacks on social media or negative commentary. Research has shown us that that's not effective in changing hearts and minds. I could have all the stats and data and, you know, arguments to rebut any of the misinformation out there, but that's not going to change people's hearts and minds if they're filled with hate and fear and negative emotions. What does work is personal stories and personal relationships. That's why we push that so much. And when people don't have the personal relationships, or they don't hear the personal stories that we could and should be sharing, what's really important is making sure our messaging is positive and it creates a sense of commonality, and that we have other people share those personal stories, even if they lack those personal relationships. So one of the things I tell people is, you know, if you hear somebody make anti-Muslim comments, even if it's at the dinner table over Thanksgiving, for instance, with your family, you don't have to debate them on that. You don't have to go into all the verses of the Quran that actually are, you know, contrary to what they say or any of that stuff. You don't have to have the statistics about actual violent threat in our country being sort of from white nationalists and supremacists. You don't need that data. All you can say is, you know what? That's not true. Let me tell you about the Muslims I know, and then share positive personal stories. And if they're not ones that you have from your own personal relationships, you can hopefully collect stories about others and hear these kinds of stories that we will be sharing through this process, and share those types of stories with your own family and networks. But there's a lot of work to be done. I know Reverend Terry has some suggestions on this question as well, but in terms of addressing the actual anti-Muslim industry, there has been exposés done. The fact that they're even known now, before they weren't known, you know, which groups are actually contributing to this. There have been reports done exposing the amount of philanthropy that has unintentionally gone into funding these kinds of groups by mainstream organizations, mainstream funders, and charitable organizations. And when they've been exposed, some of them have actually said, oh, hold on, we need to not be supporting hate basically in our country. So we're seeing some of that work being done, including where necessary and appropriate legal challenges to some of the disinformation and misinformation that they are pursuing. But I really like the focus on what we as individuals and communities can do. And I'm going to pass it over to Terry to add to that, because I know he has some great ideas.
Yeah, so you know, we're not going to try to ask you in 5 sessions to become an expert on any of this. And I've been doing this work for quite a while, and I'm still learning things, you know, every day. So it's a lot of it comes down to the power of saying, I see it differently. I have a different view. And then sharing that positive story. And then thinking about the person that's being negative for a minute, also realizing who else is in the room at the moment. And what kind of values do they have? What kind of values do they share with you? And so, like, if I'm going to talk with someone who has served in the military, for instance, I'm going to share a story about an American Muslim imam who served in the military in Vietnam, and who is a chaplain to the local police, because he wants to support them in the work that they do. I'm going to share that kind of story. And now at first you might have to work harder to develop, you know, some real life stories about American Muslims. And then don't expect it all to change at once, right? Share your story, say, I have a different view. This is the way I see it. And then share that positive story, build on those shared values, and then be patient. Because none of us got to the way we see the world overnight, and we're not going to move out of it overnight either. We got to have a lot more patience with folk, but we also have to stand up in courage to speak our own truth and to recognize that we have something to share as well. So we want to thank you, Amanda, for that question. I know we're nearing the end of our hour. I just want to thank all of you for joining us today. And Anila, you want to share something before we go?
Yep, I just wanted to say quickly, food. I know it's COVID time, we can't get together, but food is always a great way to bring people together. And if you've never been to a mosque, visit a mosque, get that personal experience yourself, and also use mainstream media and your social media to share positive personal stories or positive articles of stories rather than getting into any of the negativity. Final piece.
So Ashley, thank you, and to Adasha, and for helping to host this, and we want to turn it over to you now.
Thank you so much. I'm going to just really quickly, I'm competing for bandwidth with two virtual learners right now. I'm so glad to be here. This is something that I am not very educated in, so I think this has been really, really informational for me. So I'm really excited for the rest of this. I hope everybody else that's here can join. And for those of you who have, you know, friends and family that might be interested in this topic, you know, if you're having a hard time finding the link or anything, let me know.
So we want to thank everyone for joining us. I think Ashley put off her mic. Adasha, do you want to say something before we go?
No, definitely. Echo what Ashley said. If you have friends and family or colleagues that you know this is a sensitive topic, you know, to address, or if you've been in the room where the comments have been made and you don't know what to say, please invite them to the series. Now that you all have kind of experienced that it's just a non-threatening space for us to have. I mean, we're here to grow and learn. So just invite and spread the word. And thank you for coming.
And registration remains open, and people can still join. They can watch this video. We'll be sending the YouTube link out very soon. It didn't go on Facebook Live because Facebook's changing their software like they always do, just when we need them. But thank you so much for joining us all, and we'll hope to see you next week.